gentlemen, welcome back to the Marshal Kramer Show. I am Marshal Kramer, and this is my show, the place where I do my shit, and I talk about my stuff, and I talk about life. Quick gist, if you've never been here before, welcome. Welcome. I lost my voice there. My name is Marshal, and basically I'm a young man. I'm 23 now, just had my 23rd birthday last week, and life leaves me with a lot of questions, always has, and this is where I basically talk about them, think them out. Sometimes I do this show by myself, do a monologue. Sometimes I sit down with my friends, have a dialogue. Sometimes I sit down with other people. I haven't done that yet. Sometimes I do, but sometimes we do like an interview form. Sometimes we just shoot the shit. But we keep it light, keep it silly. We do a lot of jokes. I'm super weird, super goofy, so I like to throw a lot of that personality in here. But at the end of the day, we kind of have a serious tone and note to our thing, but to our show, to my show. But yeah. That's what it is. Marshal Kramer Show. Welcome. 23rd birthday. What I did for my birthday first, what I started it off with in the morning, because I was like, yeah, birthday time. I got a haircut. Is there anything better in this life than getting a goddamn haircut? I mean, oh my God, just sitting back. I remember when when it was on my mama's dime, I used to lay back in the beginning. Back in the Dizzy, we would do that shampoo and conditioner, baby, you know what I'm saying? So in the beginning, we would go lay down, get my hair wet instead of her spraying with it because, again, it's so thick. It's like a mop. If I was skinny, I would literally look like a mop. But, dude, I'm sitting in there, man, and she's got those buzzers, and they're just, like, buzzing up, you know? And you know what? I'm a man of conversation. I like conversation. But, like, sometimes, and, like, especially when I get a haircut, shut the fuck up. And a lot of them do. You know, do a little small talk. What you up to today? How you doing? I will do a little bit of stuff like that. But I will never initiate the conversation. And I think usually after a few questions of them asking and me responding respectfully, and I don't initiate or ask back usually. Or, like, I do, you know, I go, oh, how about you, you know. But so they usually stop and I just sit there and just feel the all around my body, just one ear to the other, man. Just like, there goes the buzzer. Right the right ear. Around to the left ear. Oh my God, this is insane, guys. Oh, guys, we're all done with the haircut. Oh, she's getting her neck. She's touching up that neck. Do you have a towel? It's the most a woman's touched me all year. But happy birthday to me, man. That's the way I started off. The other thing that happened in the haircut that I want to talk about was, so I was sitting there and I had like the first chair towards the door. So then, she kind of got started on my hair midway through the first buzz going around, like halfway through, she stopped halfway through. This is like giving me blue balls. And then because someone came in the door and she was gonna, you know, check him in. And she was like, did you check in online? And he said no. And then she goes, wait. I don't know what happened, regardless, but he came in, was gonna check in. She said, do you wanna check in online? Did you check in online? He said something, and then went back and forth, and then then the first thing I really heard after that was him going like, I've been a customer here for 20 years. What's going on here with all this technology? And then I literally, what my point was, it had nothing to do with me, and I'm sitting there on my birthday, getting ready to have a, you know, I mean, it was already started, an amazing haircut, and I'm just like, hearing this guy behind me, you know, start to have a confrontation. And this lady is like a boss. This lady was a queen. I love this. She was like taking no shit. She was a little bit a heavier set woman. And she was like, she's just sitting there just stone cold, polite, but just never budged and with emotion. Whether the guy, he started escalating his voice and she just stayed here. She's like,
oh, no, you gotta check in online.
You know, no, not meek or fearful, just like, straight to his face.
Nope. You gotta check in line. Okay. Nope. We can't do that. Yep, you gotta do that. Nope, we can't do that.
And it had nothing to do with me, but the moment it started escalating, his voice started picking up, I literally started bubbling in my body. Like I was starting to have like, not like butterflies, you know, but like, it's like a fight or flight was kicking in. Like I was a part of it. Is that like our senses? We have to just, we got spidey senses.
I'm Spider-Man.
And we're supposed to just like pick up on that shit. I was literally just talking to I was literally just, or just, I was literally just talking to a friend of mine the other day, and we were talking about the same thing that happens at bars. Like, you literally can pick up a little sense of, like, somebody's voice escalates. It's maybe it's what they said, or maybe it's how they said it, or maybe it's how loud they're actually saying it. And it's like, but it catches everyone's attention, you know? Male and female, I'm not going to say either. I haven't done the study on it, but yeah. And we were talking the same thing at the bar. And then he was kind of talking about, he's like, because he was talking about things too. And he goes like, so I was asking, like, do we just have these senses? He goes, maybe we have these senses. But he's like, I think the reason why you were, and then, is what I said to him, what I followed up was, you know, I started getting hot, but then I couldn't, like, I heard everything. Before, I was, like, waiting for her to come back with my hair. I was thinking it was just going to be a, oh, yep, check in, sit down, we'll be done. I wouldn't even hear it, right? It was just, it happened. There already was two people who checked in. It just was simple, but this guy did something different that caught my senses.
Ooh, my spider sense is tingling.
And now I could hear everything that he was saying, and then I was laughing. Because he was being a douche, and again, she was not budging. She's just like, nope, and she's like, he's like,
I've been coming here for 20 years. This is undespicable. This is rabbit-dibber dandy. You know, I'm going to get a pizza.
And then the lady just standing there. She comes right back to the haircut, doesn't say anything to me, just gets back to work. I'm like, queen, baby, nox. Then what he said, same thing with, like, but I was, like, so invested in it, and I was laughing, I was hearing everything, because it was, like, so ridiculous. And the fact that she wasn't budging, or not even just budging, she just didn't give a fuck. She's like, I deal with this every day, I don't care. Get, like, sit down and wait 25 minutes or leave. Like, I don't know what to do with you, man. And I thought that was hilarious. And he was talking about that. And we were talking about the, you know, maybe what is it specifically about the bar or this situation? And he's like, I don't know, maybe we just like to watch shit burn. Maybe we just like to see shit burn. We like to see people fucking, you know, we're hypothesizing. Maybe we like to see people just literally embarrass the shit out of themselves. And it happens a lot when you're drunk. You think about it. You don't want to be the guy who's embarrassing the shit out of himself. And a lot of times you don't want your friend to be the guy, especially when you're in a public situation, because then you're going to be the friend with the douche, you know what I'm saying? When you're on the outside of it, don't lie to yourself. When you're on the far outside of it and it's going to do nothing, to affect you. It's not at your house and it's going to break shit. You know, none of your friends are involved. You know, you don't see any threat of danger. Like, that shit's fun to watch. That's the UFC. There's a whole business about it, but they're not embarrassing themselves. But I guess you can if you get knocked out. I mean, fucking half the people, it's admirable to step in the ring. I shouldn't even say that anyway, but half the people who fight do not all the time. Sometimes it could be a tie, sometimes it could be a submission, but anyway, getting knocked the fuck out is embarrassing as shit. But hey, man, I guess you went up there. But anyway, maybe we just like to watch people crash and burn. And I was sitting there in that haircut. This is like the first confrontation I've been hearing seen in a while. I haven't been on that bar scene in a bit, but especially in a bar scene, especially, I don't know. Maybe it's the drunks, or maybe it's just younger guys. I don't know. Maybe just, I don't know. I'm just questioning this, but I just think it's hilarious. And we were talking about that. We're like, and he was telling me, he was literally talking to me for like 45 minutes, telling me stories of recent encounters that all had that same stuff. And he's just like sitting on the outside, just like, and he's laughing about it now. He goes, this is fucking hilarious. He goes, like, it's late, I want to go to bed, but like, this is good. This is live UFC. This is live reality TV. Reality TV, that's what he said. It is live reality TV. This is like physical Kardashians right here. But fucking hilarious. I love that. Dude, feeling good here in Minnesota. I don't know where y'all are from. I imagine some of y'all are from Minnesota, but the sun's been out and it's been getting warmer, man. I can see it's 9 in the morning right now, and I can see just drips and drips and drips of stuff coming off the roof and whatnot, and like all the paths are cleared and like the roads are good, and dude, it's nice. Because I struggle. I was just hanging out with my best friend yesterday, and he was talking about the same thing. He was talking about his last month or whatnot, and he's saying, yeah, it's been getting to me, man. I go, yep, same here. And it's kind of crazy sometimes how I think with like feeling bad that sometimes you don't even know, you know, until you're out of it. And I used to have that wake-up call like every winter when I was younger, and I was living with Mama Jules, and we would go on vacation and stuff every winter. Every time I went there, it was 2 days, 3 days. You know, you usually go somewhere warm with a lot of sun. You get out of your regular life. I don't know about y'all, but like I usually put my phone away. I usually always did. Another thing I used to do a lot was go out to my grandparents' farm, which is hours away from my hometown back when I grew up, and middle of nowhere. And I would just go there, keep the phone in the house if I didn't need it, if they didn't need to call me, and just go out and do whatever, and just, you know, probably the same way with hunting, fishing, just being away from it all. But even more so during these winter trips, you're out in the sun, maybe it's Florida, maybe it's Texas, you know, California. And then I just feel so good in that sun. Like, there's just something, like, it's not something to it. It's a lot of science behind it. But that sun, dude, like, I don't even, like, regardless of the rays, regardless of, like, getting your vitamin D, there's got to be, like, psychology to looking out a fucking window that is light versus looking out a window that's all gray. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, hey, don't get me wrong. Every now and again, a gray morning when I wake up and it's just gray, every now and again, a gray day is just okay, baby. Oh, my Dan and Shay. Okay, I'm gonna go feed the horse a hay. Got it. Literally, it's just that. I actually was just watching something on social media the other day about a crewmate who lives on a cruise ship, and they live, the crew members have their rooms all the way down at the bottom, which is actually underwater, and they don't have this certain one. They don't have any underwater windows, which would be super cool, right? But what they do have is they put large TVs up and straight up and down. Did you know this? I may sound really stupid, but did you know this? Like, all those menus when you walk inside at McDonald's or like fucking Burger King and shit, it's just a TV flipped up vertical. Am I like a fucking idiot that I never saw that? And like, I DoorDash. I've literally done over 2,500 deliveries. I've been it, and like, it wasn't until like a year ago I look and I'm like, I saw the symbol. I go, Panasonic. And I did it again. I go, LG. I'm like, oh, they're just fucking TVs turned vertical. That's crazy. But they had these vertical turn TVs down there, you know, placed just like windows, and then they projected in from cameras on the top deck. So then crew members could, you know, feel like they're looking outside, and then they don't have to go up fucking, you know, 20 floors. Those cruise ships are huge. They don't have to go up 20 fucking floors just to see what it's like outside. And I'm like, you know, there's no light given to them, right? There's no light coming from that TV except for that blue light and shit. There's no, like, you know, UV rays giving you vitamin D. But what he was saying is it felt better. There's just something about it. And that's what I like about just talking to my mom versus this place I got now. This place I'm in right now is a townhome. So you should be familiar with townhomes. I'm not going to explain it to you really. But this certain one has three. So it's, you know, it's one, middle, two, and then, or, you know, one, two, three. I'm in the middle. And on the other side, two. So it's like six. So side by side. Six homes clustered. So we only have one side that can have windows. One side. Granted, they have massive windows, and like, they have a skylight in upstairs where there's no windows, but there's a nice skylight. But in this kitchen area, there's no windows. And I was like, versus her home, versus their home, versus my parents' cabin, even my brother's home, like up in his living room, it's just all windows, you know. And where was I also? I was somewhere recently, and I'm like, God damn, those windows do it for me. I don't know what it is, but, you know, not even getting outside and getting that vitamin D, just looking outside at a fucking bright day is good, you know? What's it like up in Seattle? What's you Seattleers doing, huh? How does that work? What are you Portlanders doing? What are you Portlanders doing? So, another thing I wanted to talk about this week was the fact of two steps forward and one step back. I've heard that all the time, and there's an actual song. Two steps forward, one step back. Take two steps forward, take two steps back. We come together, I've always kind of heard it as like a philosophy. Not a philosophy necessarily. It's kind of like it's kind of like, it's like a scapegoat, you know? It's like what people use after they have done their step back. They're like, damn, what went wrong? I was doing so good. I felt like I was moving forward, X, Y, Z. Someone will just nudge you and be like, hey, man, two step forward, one step back, man. Two step forward, one step back, man. You know? And I was in that situation myself this past week. I was like, I said that to myself. I was like, one side, I was like, hey, man, what's going on, dude? I was like, I was feeling really good this last week, these last few weeks, doing good, X, Y, Z, and, you know, working on all these things, ABC, and now ABC ain't going so good. I don't know what to do, man. And then another side of me is like,
Amen. Two steps forward, one step back, man.
You know what I'm saying? And I go, ah, yes. Two steps forward, one step back.
Amen. Two steps forward, one step back, man.
And I'm like, all right, Roger. And, but I was thinking about it. And I'm like, why are these things that have been on the forefront of my mind, have been my priority to fix, this ABC, right? That they were doing so good. And I was like, two steps forward, one step back. Okay, well, think about it. If I'm a big guy who loves efficiency, that doesn't sound very efficient. Why does it, or not even that. I'm a guy who likes to question the why.
Why?
Why two steps forward, one step back? Not only why is that just is, why have I done it? You know, what is the good in it? Or whatever. Why? Why does it exist? And I just started thinking about it with myself. I'm like, this is for me. Is it maybe? Because I thought myself, right? Also, would it not be more efficient just to like slowly go forward one step at a time? You know? And maybe one step forward and a tenth of a step back? Just a rock back, you know, like your car when you stop, you rock back, then you go forward again. Then you rock back a little bit and you go forward. I was like, that seems a little bit more efficient. Why do I feel that I follow underneath that philosophy or pattern of life? Is that two steps forward, one step back? And I thought, is there a possibility that I just get ahead of myself? I move too fast. I'm on the racetrack of life, you know, and I'm just left and left and left, Indy 500. I'm just going, taking no pit stops. And it's in these pit stops, it's in those quick rock backs at the stoplight, you know, that gives me the time to check the field as a quarterback, right, and observe everything. And then decide what's going on versus when you're just revving it and you're just on that track revving it. I tend to put blinders on and I don't see anything else. Again, I'm putting so much blinders on, I don't even take a pit stop. And that's very important in the racetrack world and in racing, right? And you're in this metaphor here, where our body and our life, we are the race car. I got to take pit stops. And pit stops can come in many different ways. It's just ways that allow me to step back and reflect, recharge, regroup, recoup, you know. And by doing those two, I kind of like change how I feel about things and what I really want from things. And, you know, maybe there's an argument saying like, well, that's exactly how you get diverted from your path. You just got to be blinders on and just go straight forward and be selfish and, you know, go to the top. And that's all right. Hey, fuck, maybe. I don't know. What the fuck do I know? I'm just shooting a shit here to a camera, middle of my home here. but I don't know. So I was like, what do you think I could do to stop this? But I think I have been slowing it down. I'll tell you that. You know, I don't want to get ahead of myself. I feel like I've always been talking about, you know, like, here's what I got to do better. Here's what I did bad. Here's what I got to do better. I don't think I talk enough about, and, you know, I want to preach this. I want everyone to fucking reflect in their life. I don't think I don't talk enough about how far I've come, you know?
That's what she said.
God, I'm such a child. Not too far in the bedroom.
Oh, shit. Yeah. Give it to me.
Back to the show. But how far I've come and how much progress I've made in so many avenues of my life. How many times I've set a priority for working on my goal, working on myself, and discipline, work ethic, relationships, communication, right? When I picked all those different avenues at different times in my life, you know, there's a lot of things I fucking massively improved on. So pat on the goddamn back. But, you know, what can I do in the future? Because there's so many things. I'm not, you know what I'm saying? I'm not near perfection. And again, I think I've talked about this before. Perfection is something I want to reach at my deathbed, per se, right? I may not be in the perfect health, but I want the perfect feeling of perfection. Maybe never. Maybe I don't even want it ever. But if it is anything, I want it at my last second. Because after perfection, if that even exists, what the fuck comes after? And that's right there shows you how deep we can go. But guess what we're doing, baby? We're pulling back up. We're coming back in that shallow land. All right? Let's do this. But there are some things that I don't do too well with. And there's going to be things in the future that I don't do too well with. And how can I not get ahead of myself? How can I just slowly, right? I've talked about that song from Santa Claus Coming to Town. Put one foot in front of the other. And soon you'll be walking across the floor. And it's like this idea of slowing down a little bit. And like it's, and I mean this in a totally different way. Slowing down is a mentality to me. It's not a physical thing. It maybe will manifest itself, but it starts with the mindset of just like, you know, I'm not thinking as fast. I'm not, I have plans. I have goals. But look, like honestly, right now, something very relevant. Look at Russia and Ukraine. Like this doesn't sound, you know, hippy-jippy, but dude, something can happen today, you know, and not even you die, but tomorrow, COVID. You thought you were going to go to school on Monday, you know, in 2020 in March, right? You thought you were going to go to school on Monday. You thought you were going to come back from spring break like me. You thought you were going to play in a state championship, you know, Minnesota girls basketball and stuff like that, right? You thought you were going to play in a championship. Nope. Next thing you know, your whole world got shut down. Dude, anything can fucking happen. So I don't like to, I like, it's this balance. It's this duality for me of living in the present. You know, being focused with the now and being focused with just, a few hours and days from now versus this big grand plan of my life. Because, you know, again, probability of me having a long life, it's likely, very likely. We can see it's happened for billions of people, millions of people. It's, you can get a long life. Yeah, I'm just not thinking as fast, you know. The future is going to come, but like today, you know, I'm just going to really worry about what I can do today. And by doing that, I naturally enter a state of moving slower. You know what I'm saying? And I don't know how to talk about this. It's a deep thing. I would love to. That's why dialogues are sometimes the best. But, you know, moving slower, yeah, it's just not a bad thing. I don't know. Again, you got to do your own thing. But for me, I was just kind of thinking about where my stresses come from and, you know, X, Y, Z. And a lot of my stresses come from that two-step thing, thinking there's a place that I need to be, thinking that there's a level that I need to be at this current moment. You know what I'm saying? And I don't. I don't. Maybe you do. Do your thing. But I don't. And I don't want that. And I've realized, you know, especially the times I've taken off from podcasts and stuff, because it's a mindset thing. Back in the day when I did my podcast, I had a whole different expectation for it of the outcome versus than I do now. You know, same gist of, you know, I would like to do it professionally. I would like to. It's something I feel like I feel like I'm decent at, right? I feel like I could do it. You know, maybe you may not agree with the subject matter, but, you know, I could find a subject matter that could be entertaining to people at a mass scale, right? Regardless, anyway. Back in the day, I just wanted it for fame. I wanted to be, you know, listen to me, recognize my words. I'm a prophet. But, you know, and now I just kind of am like, I don't know. There's no place I need to be. All I know is that what I like to do today is like, I like to work hard, you know? And so I'm just going to work hard today. That's my only goal today. And and tomorrow and the next day. I'm just really worried about that. I'm not looking forward to, you know, a month from now. It's like, you know, I am. But when that time gets there, I'm not thinking about it because that takes away from the day. Every thought for a month from now when I go on a vacation or something takes away from me being able to be present today. I was literally just talking to my mom yesterday. Dude, when I'm in work, this is what I do. I do DoorDash, right? So besides, you know, podcasting, doing my Marshal Kramer Media, you know, left and right, all these little other things I do, little manual labor stuff, whatever. But when I do DoorDash, and even anything else, not even that's that, go to the gym, go to the grocery store, whatever, dude. What I do is I put a earpiece in my ear, right? A little headphone, Bluetooth. Have my phone, listen to a podcast, I have my head down. If it's winter, I'll have my hood up, you know, whatever. I just like don't look at anybody. I don't want to talk to anybody because I feel that I'm waiting for these things. I'm like, you know, I'm just trying to work right now. I'm not trying to meet nobody, or I'm just trying to be at the gym right now. I'm not trying to meet nobody. I'm just going to the gas station. I'm not going to meet anybody. I'm not going to meet somebody at the gas station, dude. You know, it's like all these things. That's just an example. I'm not going to meet someone at the gym. I was just throwing all these things. I was like trying to force this reality in my life. Like, this is how it's going to fucking be. And then I would just put blinders on for anything that I didn't care about. But then when I went to the bar, or when I was going to shoot on a music video shoot and there would be a bunch of people there, or, you know, I was going to a party, whatever, right? Or I was going out to eat with a bunch of people, right? It was always those that I waited to take my blinders off. I'd be like, all right, now I'm going to sit back and watch the magic happen. You're going to wait and see how much happens for me. You know, dude, people are going to be loving me. People are going to be coming up to me. You know, I'm going to meet so many cool people. People who are going to give me a career. I'm going to meet a nice girl, XYZ. And it never happened, because at that time, I was literally looking so hard that, like, the universe was saying, nah, man, not fucking happening for you, dude. Not fucking happening for you. Kind of like that story, right, where the guy's drowning in the water. And he's like, a boat comes and he goes, would you like to help? And the guy goes, no, God will save me. Another boat comes, you need help? Nope, God will save me. And then he drowns, dies, goes to heaven, asks God. He goes, God, why don't you come and save me? He goes,
I sent you two fucking boats.
It's something like that. It's like, I don't know if it's the word of seeing the forest through the trees, but it's like you're looking so hard for something that you can't see. You have blinders on. You're not seeing the stuff around you. So I go, let's slow down. Marsh, take the earpiece out, take the headset off, take the hood off, and look around. You have no idea. First off, they always have came up to me, but any DoorDasher, instantly when you walk into a restaurant and you have a red bag and somebody else has a red bag, boom, instant rapport, instant, you know, something to talk about. You know, hey, how you doing today? What's it like out there? You don't do it? Even an Uber Eats or a Grubhub, you got an instant rapport. And I would never do it because, again, I would have my blinders on, but people would come up and talk to me. And when they came and talked to me, I would talk back and we'd have good conversations. So what if one time you talk to somebody, I do DoorDash, but then I sit in with these guys and maybe there's a 35-year-old guy and I'm like, this guy doing DoorDash at 35. And I'm like, you're fucking doing DoorDash, you fucking fuck. Fuck you, man. that deserve all those Effenheimers. No, like, screw Marsh. Why am I being so judgmental towards this guy? Like, next thing you know, like, and regardless of that, look at me trying to find things for myself. But next thing you know, that guy's like, you know, he's got, you know, work for me. I do this part-time. I'm actually a head coach of a basketball team or something. And I go, oh, well, I shoot sports videos and sports photos. He goes, oh shit, boom, got a job. Next thing you know, there's a girl who comes up to you. You go up to a girl, you have your headphones off so you're aware of stuff. You see a beautiful DoorDashing gal, which I've seen a few of them. What's up, guys? I've seen a few of y'all. And you know, you say something like, hey, how you doing today? You know, how's the making some money? You know? And it's good to always talk too, because you can always, you know, learn a little bit. I've learned good cheats, you know. Everyone's got their own little hacks about how to make a little bit more money per hour, so it's nice to talk to them anyway. But when I got my goddamn blinders on, and I'm not trying to see nothing, because this is not the place I'm going to meet anybody. This is not the place I'm going to meet anybody of substance. Somebody that can give me something, somebody that can benefit my life. It's like, shut the fuck up. Almost anyone can benefit your life by giving you just a smile. Sounds stupid, but hey, man, it's kind of how the way it is. And, you know, tying into all that two steps forward and one step back thing, you know, I've been realizing my life. I was really lonely and sad for a little bit here, but that kind of is what it is. It happens around the winter time and XYZ. It does what it does. But it was what kind of started my realization. This is of a one step back, that I've been taking a one step back these last few months here, this last month. And I was like, why? Again, all the reasons I listed earlier. And, you know, I was like, well, what can I do about it? And I said, you know, moving slower was one. And the other thing was just, you know, me and my friend hate this line, but just doing my own thing. I think I've talked about it before, when I'm not doing my own thing or I'm not doing anything for myself, I'm always sitting around and fretting about shit and feeling sad. And I was telling my mom, I used the description of I'm like a dog, like a puppy dog. I just had her dogs here the last week. They got two of them. Mom was out of town, and I and then dad went out of town too. So they had me watch the dogs, and I loved it. It was great. And there's one, Lucy is super needy, but and I'm just like, you know, I felt like her. That's what I feel like at times, because, you know, mom leaves or I leave the house and she follows us to the door and cries as we leave and then sits around moping until somebody comes back, just waiting for something to happen for her instead of doing something for herself, waiting for someone to make enjoyment for her instead of making enjoyment for herself. And, you know, regardless of what it is for her, it's dogs, I don't know, but that, I'm just using that example. Am I, you know, you probably heard this line from your parents before. I've heard it all. I've heard it from my dad before, for sure. But boring people are boring, or bored people get bored. Like, boring people get bored. It's you. You can make your own fun, XYZ, or you can make, you know, your whatever mindset situation that I'm talking about here, you know. So I stopped waiting around like a puppy dog, you know. Not that everything's going to happen for you, but I just wanted to start giving myself a chance. And I've been such a facade most of my life with, you know, everyone thinking, I want people to think of this one way of me, and, you know, this way of me, Marshall being this hard worker, Marshall being this and that. And he is, because that's who he is at his nature. He was, as a young kid, he was the guy who, he was the little kid who, you know, loved to just work in the yard and just work while kids did a lot of other sports and stuff. That's what I love to do. I just like to work. But then, you know, I grew up a little bit, got in like eighth grade and really started caring about popularity. And then you get to about 10th grade, 11th grade, and I'm not gonna lie, I started caring about, you know, girls and drugs and alcohol, right? It was just that. It was just partying. It was just about the immediate moment, have as much fun as possible. And, you know, nothing's wrong with that. I mean, nothing's wrong with that. But I got away from myself. Like, again, it wasn't like on the weekends. That is what it is. It was an all day, every day thing, you know, with different chapters of things in my life. You know, it'd be all day, every day for weeks, I'd be obsessing over this. And then all day, every day for weeks, I'd be obsessing over this. And then this, A, B, C, just do a cycle. You know, I know during this part of the year, I obsessed over alcohol and food every winter, dude. I feel disgusting. I lose literally like 75% of my fucking wardrobe. So anyway, when I get so out of hand, you know, when I get so out of hand, I wasn't doing anything for myself. And this made me nothing you even struggle with, going so off the rail like that. Because I got buddies that do not. I got buddies that do. You know, I just go so off the rail. And for years, I try to fix it, right? Because I was aware of it. And I always thought you just had to hop on that fucking racetrack and just rev and just fucking go until your tires burst and your magical ones will be put on and you just keep going for the rest of your life and you'll make it to where you want to go. And I was like, there's pit stops. I have to slow down and take pit stops. Again, even the fastest sport, right? You can call it, that's a sport, right? The fastest sport, pit stops. It's all about checking in with your vehicle, checking in with yourself, self-reflection, taking your goddamn pit stop and just reflecting. And so many different things will come for me with that. Not even just motivation, inspiration. I'll be able to navigate a path for myself, see what I really want, and whatever. And with that tie-in of, you know, doing my own thing and doing the work, I've been my own boss, right? I do DoorDash, right? And so that boss is my phone. My phone tells me what happens, right? Where I can go, what orders I can have, right? I can't just make up orders. I can't just walk into a random place, be like, give me all this shit. I'm going to take it out to somebody. They're going to give me $100. And then, you know, I do the podcast. I do, and then Marshal Kramer Media, which, you know, my own boss. And then my own boss, myself cleaning my house, my own boss, myself doing hygiene, my own boss of making sure I work out, right? And my boss, you know, I'm a boss of myself. And I was telling my parents, for me, being my own boss no longer is letting me do and allowing myself to do whatever the fuck I want whenever I want. That's not it at all. And I said to my mom and dad that for me, it's making my own schedule. That's merely it. I get to set something whenever I want, but I have to stick to that. Joe Rogan always said that, you know, about when he wrote jokes. And I hear a lot of very, very well-known writers and who write, you know, novels and books and people who do, you know, art and rap and whatever, write for raps and stuff. A lot of them, what works best for them, and I know what works best for me, is literally scheduling a time for your whole week, making your own schedule. Be like, all right, Friday I want to work for these 3 hours here, this here, right? Very flexible to you. But then when that day comes, that time comes, there's no choice. And that's what I said to myself, is that I've taken away that choice. I get the choice of setting it, but once it's set in stone, it's set in stone and I'm sticking to it. In the future, I hope to start being able to develop regain that flexibility, but I don't have that choice right now because it's detrimental to me and I've seen what it does to myself. I let myself go. If I get the choice to do whatever I want,
I'm gonna do whatever the fuck I wanna do.
This podcast is something I like to do. It's a podcast. It's so much fun and I love editing. And this is like, this podcast has helped out my editing skills the most from my short films and even my business in Marshal Media. Yeah. I love it. I just love it. But even this I don't want to do sometimes because this, doing this right now or sitting in my living room over there with a bottle of vodka with some steak and shrimp cooking up and a horror movie on. Nah, that's what I'm going to go do. And not steak and shrimp that I can afford. But in my dream, it's whip it up, all right? But no, I'm going to do that, you know? Oh, go work for 3 hours and do DoorDash? Or literally just sit in my bed and sleep for an extra few hours? That's what I'm going to do, right? So that's just what I struggle with. And feeling a lot better about it now. And I love it. Right now I got to export all this. And then I got to get going. Got to get to the gym and I got to get to work. Taking that choice away from me. And the other choice that I'm taking away is that pit stops are a mandatory thing for me. I don't get a choice anymore. It is what it is, but it works for me. So that's it for me today, talking to myself about two steps forward, one step back, and just trying to figure that out and how to get it more efficient, slowly moving forward by doing my own thing, being productive for myself, taking the choice away from myself, sticking to what I say I'm gonna do, willpower, discipline, integrity. And that was it for me. So thanks for tuning in, thanks for listening, guys. I know it wasn't that funny of a one, but it was a real one for me, and it's something I need to talk about right now at this time. So thank you for tuning in. Until next time, take care, my friends, and scoop.
See, we was cool right before I hit your fist, but he hit the fan when I got him down and pinched. But I took a break, I had to leave and go get cleansed.